Hello, I'm Fabrice Barzi. I'm here today to talk with my guest about the adventures in Legal Land that we had last year.
Hi, I'm Hellen, and yes, I was caught over a speeding trial last year, and we're here to tell you about how we went about getting the charges dismissed.
The first of the basic principles that we used was we tried our best to ensure that we were treated fairly. And we'll refer to this throughout this video. And we did that by asking a series of setup questions. Some of the examples of the setup questions.
Questions such as, am I entitled to a fair and meaningful hearing today? Am I entitled to responsive answers to my questions? But we finish those questions with yes or no, so that we're asking them to close down their answers, because otherwise they can give you very long answers.
So that brings us to the first really basic principle that we used, which was asking two basic questions, which were evidence of a complaining party, i.e. somebody whose rights had been infringed by Hellen's behaviour and actions that day. And the second very important question or request for evidence is evidence that the laws and the statutes and the codes apply to Hellen. The next principle or common theme that we used was that not being trained lawyers, that we don't understand the proceedings that are going on, the cause and nature of the proceedings. And part of their rules show that you can only make a plea, a knowing plea, if you understand exactly what it is that you're pleading to, if you understand the cause and nature of the proceedings and the crime that you're admitting responsibility for. And as you hadn't been informed, as we hadn't been informed of any evidence of the codes applying, as we hadn't been informed of any evidence of a complaining party, we don't fully understand the cause and nature of these proceedings. Mm. The next general principle that applied throughout these whole proceedings was the prosecution has the burden of proof to prove their case, to prove that the laws are applicable, and to prove that what you did was a criminal act. That brings us to the last principle, really, which is holding the prosecution to account. If they don't fulfil their burden of proof, i.e. proving that the laws apply with evidence, proving that there is a complaining party who has standing to file a complaint against you, then you hold them to account. And in this country, using the criminal justice procedure rules, there are also guidelines from the Crown Prosecution Service. And another thing that we attempt to do is, in the criminal justice procedure rules, at every hearing they're attempting to move the proceedings on as swiftly as possible. And so if we can identify what it is that we want from the prosecution, evidence of the laws applying, evidence of a complaining party, then hopefully when we're in preliminary stages, they will ask the prosecution to bring forward all that disclosure by a fixed date, and hold them to that, so that if you don't have that information by a trial, that you start the paper trail.
I think it's important to note, though, it's not easy to get that. You have to ask the right question, which we'll go into more, but you need to ask the right questions at the right time to get them to put an order that things have to be provided by a certain date. It didn't just happen by itself, that it was something we had to request.
Yes, and also the paper trail. As I said as well, recording these things, referring to these things in subsequent pieces of paperwork, which kind of brings us right back to the beginning, really. And what was the first sort of piece of paperwork or interaction that you had on this matter?
Well, the first thing was a notification from Sussex Police that a camera had taken a picture of my car travelling at 36 miles an hour and a 30 mile an hour limit. I'm looking at this piece of paper and I'm thinking, yeah, I'm not aware of the authority that they hold over me to bring these charges against me. So I'm not saying they haven't got it, but I would like to see the evidence of it. So that's where we're starting from. I didn't answer their letters because I didn't see anywhere that it explained that they did have authority over me.
As you've been asking these questions, I know I've asked these questions in relation to the obligation for tax. We've also asked the police in terms of other offences that they label criminal.
Yeah, we visited the police station and asked them, asked the chap, nice chap on the desk, how our obligation is created.
Very much our section of it, we uphold the law,
So, do you know how your obligation was created? You have to drive within those certain regulations, but do you know how you agreed to live within that?
It would be under an act, wouldn't it? It would have come in under an act. Have you
read that? But the acts are applicable to you. Did you ever agree to abide by the acts?
As an element of living in this country is abiding by that act, isn't it? You agree to our law.
The question is, because in each area you're within, we're in Worthing Borough Council, so we have to live by Worthing Borough Council's rules. But Worthing Borough Council isn't a geographical area, it's a legal entity.
Well, criminal law spreads throughout the nation.
We're talking about a legal entity. All we kept getting back on our investigation was you need to ask the courts. And unfortunately, you can't ask the courts unless you're up in court. So, when this was an opportunity, really, I didn't go out of my way to get a speeding ticket. It was a long time before asking these questions that one came along, but it did. And it's a kind of safe way to go in there and try this out. And it's been a really interesting experience. Before the plea hearing, went and asked to have a little look around the courtroom, which they found, apparently no one had ever asked to do that before. I found it quite an unusual request, but they did let me in. I'd gone at the time and there wasn't a trial going on. I just went to get my bearings, so I knew the room before the trial started. I think that helped a bit. But mostly, I mean, I didn't go in there on my own at all. I went in there with my Mackenzie friend, which was you, and I went in there with a media rep and other witnesses in the public gallery taking notes and recording things, people I trusted to do it fairly. That had several benefits. One is that you do get a fair recording of what's happening in the trial, as we're not allowed to record in UK courts. And they don't either record in the magistrates' court. There is no actual audio recording. There's only notes.
Which, in your case, with the first magistrates' court, was a great help, because...
we've discovered, doesn't always accurately relay what's happened in court, and because we had a record ourselves, we were able to contest some of that stuff, which was very useful. The other benefit it has is the empowerment of it, that you're not on your own. You've got people you trust in there with you. If I'd been in there on my own, I wouldn't have been able to be as confident and ask questions like I did. At no point am I pleading not guilty, because if they can prove that what they're bringing to court is a valid charge against me, I haven't at any point denied that I drove my car at that speed on that road. It's their statute, their rule, that I'm arguing against, because I don't feel I'm a criminal for doing what I did, because it was an empty dual carriageway road.
And this is the relevance of the question: is there evidence of a complaining party?
Yes.
Because a complaining party is somebody who you've infringed their rights of. If you take something that isn't yours, then you give somebody a complaining standing to be a complaining party. If you hit somebody over the head with intent, you give them standing to be a complaining party. So that's what that question is asking for. Is saying, if I am a criminal, who did I commit the crime against?
Yes.
How did that pan out at that first magistrate's
hearing? Well, the spokes magistrate got very angry with me. She threatened me with how much it would cost if I continued to delay proceedings when I wasn't delaying any proceedings. I was saying, can I ask, because she said I wasn't able to answer the question. She let me ask if it was a fair and meaningful hearing.
Yes.
She wouldn't answer meaningful. She said she would answer, it would be fair. But when I asked her, what evidence they rely on that the laws apply, she said, the laws apply, that's it. And I was asking to back it in evidence. It was making her very angry. Every time I objected, eventually told me I wasn't allowed to object. It's a long time ago now. I'm trying to remember exactly what she said. She was threatening me about the cost of the proceedings. She was telling me that the law applies because the law says so. She was basically using what we call a circular argument.
Were you being threatened and coerced and placed under extreme duress in that environment? Did you plead?
No.
No, so there was a plea carried forward.
They argued that they couldn't actually progress any further without a plea. They wouldn't let me answer the questions because they wouldn't answer my questions because it was just a plea hearing. So they said they'd have to have a case management hearing, but they couldn't call a case management hearing without a plea. And I said, well, and they're only supposed to enter a plea on your behalf if you refuse to enter a plea. And I wasn't refusing. I was asking for a bit more clarity on the nature of the charge. But they did, in the end, even though I'm saying that I was very happy to plead guilty if I could see the evidence before me that I definitely committed a crime. That was all I was asking for. Then I wouldn't happily, but, you know, then I would deal with it. I would take responsibility.
The next hearing was a couple of weeks later, which was the case management hearing.
Yeah.
And that wasn't before magistrates, was it?
No, that was in front of a district judge.
Okay. And were you able to get your basic set-up questions answered so that you were actually able to be treated fairly at that hearing?
For me, that hearing was a whole different, you know, experience. He did allow me this time and space to answer, and he answered fairly responsibly. And as far as I'm concerned, we got what we needed to actually get these charges dismissed in that case management hearing by him setting some orders,
so what
holding the prosecution to account.
So what kind of confirmations did you get for when you were actually being treated fairly?
I just want to say, at that point in the trial was when, you know, when we established that evidence, you know, so then I asked if, so the burden of proof is on the prosecution, they've got to prove the jurisdiction, that I've been asking them to do that, they haven't done it, can they be asked to do that? And Pat taps me and says, get a date, you know, so that's
how
we held them to
got?
Account. So then I say, you know, so he says, yes, they do need to provide you with whatever they're using, you know. And he gave them, well, actually, just before that, they did attempt to give us the evidence, in their opinion, that we were asking for. So they got out the Blackstone, the Blackstone Criminal Practice 2013, paragraph A8.2, page 147. And it basically states that the laws apply to every UK citizen, every citizen within England and Wales.
Yes.
And that's what they read out. But what they're reading out to me is the law. What I'm asking for is the applicability of the law. I'm not denying that they have a law. And this is what they find it difficult to get their heads around. So yes, I know you have that law and you choose to live by it. But you're telling me that I have an obligation. And I'm asking you, okay, how was it created? And in a courtroom, you have to back things up with facts and evidence, and that's what they're not able to do, is provide me with any evidence of how the obligation was created.
Now, you say you've been asking this question a long time. So are there any people who you've found who do have an obligation?
Well, we've come across, you know, if you come from another country and you do a citizenship exam, and to qualify you to stay, there, within that is an oath of allegiance to the Crown. I think it's to the Queen. No, to the Queen.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that's different. And so they within that you do take an oath to abide by the laws and.
So that's a contract, as it were.
Yes.
So if somebody who was in that position went into court, they could then turn around and say, "There is your evidence.
Yeah.
Here is a signed and witnessed." Okay, that's really interesting to know. You managed to get a time for the prosecution to give the evidence that you'd established, that they have to give you evidence of every element of the crime, and that they had to give it to you within a set amount of time, was that?
Yeah, he actually put an order on the prosecution to provide me with any and all evidence they were going to use for the trial within 28 days to give me ample time to prepare for the trial.
Because your trial wasn't scheduled for a further 158
days.
This
was March, and my trial wasn't scheduled until August.
5 months later.
So they were given a month to provide me with the evidence they wanted to use, and that order was put on them.
And did you receive did you receive the information that you wanted within 28 days that you requested?
No, I received
so
a letter.
It wasn't responsive.
I received a letter within about 14 days. Quoting exactly what they'd said in court, that had already the district judge had accepted as evidence, you know, of applicability of the law, the same thing I quoted a minute ago, the reference to. Yeah, the Blackstones. So that it just contained that, and then a little sentence underneath saying that the bench will take judicial review of this matter, which means judicial notice of this matter, which means that they're saying that a bench is able to say actually you don't have to prove that when it's completely self-evident that it's true. So that's the argument they're saying. But if something's self-evident, surely they can show me. It will let it present itself or show it to me. So the 28 days ran out. All I'd had was that letter. A couple of months went by. Previously,
before that, you'd had two witness statements as well, hadn't you?
I'd had two witness statements.
Okay. And
a picture of my car.
And a picture of your car, allegedly travelling at criminal speeds. Interfering nobody but particles of air. And
empty road.
Before the trial came, did you get any mail a few days before?
Yep, I got their disclosure package 130 days late, 4 days before the trial, with two new witness statements, still no evidence of applicability of the law.
Two new witnesses had miraculously appeared, and you had no response to the questions that by then you'd been asking for 6 months and been entitled to an answer.
I mean, within this is a letter stating, I have all the paperwork, we'll make sure everyone can see copies of it, but stating that I had 7 days to call these witnesses to court if I wanted them to be there. Well, they sent it out 4 days before the trial, so I had to be pretty quick in faxing them the next day to say, yes, please, I want all witnesses at the trial, and did a copy to the court. Because we'd already had answers to the opening questions, I was just asking them, at the last hearing, the court confirmed that I was entitled to a fair hearing. At the last hearing, the court confirmed that I'm entitled to responsive answers to my questions. And I gave them the opportunity to change that if it wasn't the case in this hearing. So I managed to get through a whole load of stuff that we'd already had agreed by the district judge. And they had to
In terms of that general principle of being treated fairly, and you have a number of questions you might as well touch on it now, that if you're not being treated fairly, that you start asking.
I'm representing myself, you're not representing me, who are you representing? And so then there are moments they're representing the Crown. Well, if they're representing everybody in that room except me and my people supporting me are representing the Crown, including the prosecution. Now, surely that is a conflict of interest. At the trial, they did have the witnesses. Yes, of course they did. They had two witnesses of the four that they named and that I'd asked for, two of them were there. It's the first time I've ever cross-examined a witness. He got very upset. He was an ex-policeman. They often are the camera technicians, I discovered. But he still works for Sussex Police, but not as a police officer. And he'd examined the camera and the film. And is in charge. He's just in charge of everything about that camera, you know, the road markings, all of it. Yeah. So, but the questions I'm asking him are about his legal determinations that you know, having a photograph of my car on that road constitutes a crime. And he got quite cross because obviously he'd been a police officer and he was like, if you're in with West Sussex, we have jurisdiction over you. And that's that. And so we got into is West Sussex a geographical area or is Worthing a geographical area? I think it's the borough of Worthing on their charge, isn't it?
The Petty Sessional District.
Petty Sessional Division of Worthing. And I was trying to get them to define, you know, is that that piece of road or is that the legal entity that governs over that area? Mm. Which, of course, that's what it is. So what I'm asking for is how he knows I'm within their jurisdiction.
Yeah. Within that entity known as the Petty Sessional District of Worthing Borough Council, and not merely just present on the land, which has been known as Worthing since the last Ice Age.
It was there a long time before the Petty Sessional Division was, so how did I become part of that? Yeah.
And he wasn't the most responsive witness.
No, because a lot of the questions sound very similar. They start with the same phrase, and then they're asking a question about standing or complaining party or jurisdiction. So the main context of the question changes, but they're the same question over a different element of the charge, because we need to get answers for all of them. Well, because he's not paying attention properly, and obviously nor are the magistrates, he thinks I'm repeating my question. And some questions I am repeating, because he's answering with a load of waffle when it's a simple yes or no answer. So I'm repeating it and asking him if I could have, because I don't really understand the jargon he's using, could I have a yes or no answer? And he would eventually give me one if I pushed for it. Sometimes it would take me 3 times. And then I was told I was delaying things. So I just politely said that, you know, if you answer my question responsibly the first time, it will go through a lot quicker. But then I got accused of repeating myself again, and I hadn't. They were entirely different contexts to each question. They just sounded, the wording was similar.
You repeated all three questions.
Yeah, and I had to repeat all three to the court to establish that they were very different questions.
There were a number of questions that were quite relevant, that they were questioning exactly how relevant it was to establish every time the camera flashed whether somebody had committed an offence. Which is what the...
And he said, yes, absolutely. Every time a camera flashes, an offence has been committed. Well, clearly that's not true, because they must have emergency services going through there. They must have other... a diplomatic car.
Example.
You know, there's all sorts of examples where there are exemptions from that rule. So rather than just identifying the exemptions, what I would like to know is where the obligation comes from. So, you know, if some people are exempt and some people aren't, those people must have an obligation. Where is it?
He wasn't actually able to bring forth any personal first-hand knowledge or evidence of the applicability of the Road Traffic Act,
He didn't know how my obligation was created.
And for the second witness, that was pretty much the same.
It was pretty much cut and dry. All he'd ever done was hand post a notice through my door, so there wasn't really much.
And he didn't make a legal determination.
No, I asked him if he was making any legal determinations, and he said he wasn't. So we didn't spend much time with him.
Okay, and at that point, I mean, it had been nearly 2 hours into the proceedings, or maybe a little bit, about 2 hours into the proceedings, I think.
And they tried to call a third witness, enter a witness statement.
Written witness statements that you'd only seen a few days before, and that were well behind the due disclosure date, as ruled by the district judge.
Yes. So, what happened?
You objected firmly.
And
I remember that.
Yeah, and
where the proceedings started.
First of all, they asked me about are your questions relevant and all this? Mm. And I said I want to question on their competence and credibility. Everybody has the right to question any witness that ever stands against them. So, I knew...
On their competence and credibility and the veracity of their statements, the veracity of their testimony.
The veracity of their statement, yeah. So everybody can do that. So the fact they weren't there was an abuse process. So I was saying, no, I'm not happy to accept that. I requested them be here despite them putting the evidence in 130 days. What are you going to do about them putting in their evidence 130 days outside the 28-day court order? Come on, let's have some answers.
Yeah.
And they said, well, if you're going to insist with this line, it's an abusive process.
Yes.
And we'll have to have a separate hearing, an abusive process hearing, in order to establish whether an abusive process has taken place. So I said, okay, I think we should do that.
Yeah.
And
That brought a halt to the proceedings for that day. Well, it brought a halt to any meaningful proceeding. They then proceeded to spend 45 minutes attempting to...
Well, they gave me a good telling off. They said to me... Because also earlier, with trying to prove, the magistrate had said to me, surely your driving licence is your obligation. Well, it's not. We've done our research.
Contract.
It's not a valid contract, and they'll confirm that with you. And then he said my passport, which I don't have one, which I don't. But even if I did, it's, again, not a valid contract. And then he tried my birth certificate. So something my parents did before I've got any conscious memory is my obligation, and no one bothered to inform me of it.
So then he tried my car insurance. That
which
makes
is
around
more
as much
absurd.
Sense with a birth certificate as in North Korea, I believe they punish 3 generations for one person's alleged crime.
Well, I'm a slave obligation was created at my birth.
Well, in that case, it would make around as much sense as if your parents chopped off somebody's head, you being responsible for that crime.
Yeah.
And that was clearly demonstrated with the court, but they persisted still. Even after that with car insurance.
Car insurance, how absurd is that? I get my car insurance because if I hurt somebody, it's covered, or if I hurt myself, whatever, you know, is to protect for accidents. That's why people have car insurance. The fact they've made it a legal obligation is something aside to that, really. So to ask me if my car insurance is my obligation to abide by the Road Traffic Act seems a bit peculiar. It's like they were clutching at straws.
We then get another hearing, a notification of another hearing, because the prosecution has stated that their remaining witnesses aren't available.
No, the same, that's the one we just talked through. It's the one where the witnesses weren't available. We then get a letter saying that we're going to have another rescheduling hearing because the prosecutor's off sick.
Yes.
And so it's only, like the bench, it needs to be everybody the same as it was in the beginning of the trial for the trial to continue. So it can't continue, which is just a couple of days after they said the witnesses aren't available. No, they rung in court, didn't they? They rung the witnesses from the court and discovered the witnesses were available. And
with
that's
help from your information.
Yeah, because what had happened is they'd been called on the wrong day. They'd been called to the abuse of process hearing that couldn't happen. It was a farce. Anyway, with my help, the legal clerk got them to call the witnesses in court, and the witnesses were available for the trial on the 11th of October, so it was agreed that it would all go ahead. And then we got this next one saying the prosecution was off sick, so could we delay the trial? It just seemed a bit absurd. And complained, actually, because they were saying we discovered that she'd been off for a few weeks, and in that time we'd had a hearing where they could have brought that matter to the table and didn't. And we said, we've been told it absolutely has to finish. I've been to court this many times, and we were in front of a lady district judge this time. Mm-hmm. And she absolutely agreed with us and said, no, they've had ample time to let us know she's off sick. They've left it to a couple of days before the trial. They've already tried once to have a rescheduling. No, I'm not going to allow it. The trial goes ahead on Friday. Well, then on Thursday afternoon, that was the Tuesday, the trial was on the Friday. On Thursday afternoon, I get a call from the court. You won't be needed in court in the morning because your hearing has been rescheduled. Who made a ruling in between then and Thursday, without me being notified it was taking place and without me being consulted, to say that the trial is no longer taking place? And nobody could answer that question. So we said, well, we'll turn up. And they said, well, it'll be a rescheduling hearing. So we turn up on the day that they've absolutely ordered me to be there, give me a big telling off about it will be dealt with. The magistrates didn't turn up. The legal clerk had been moved to another town. The prosecutor was still off sick, and there was no witnesses. So, you know, nobody except us turned up. We were put in front of a bench of magistrates who took one look at it and said, we can't deal with this. You know, there's nothing we can do.
Eventually, we go in front of a district judge.
So we wait around and we have another hearing.
Who would have been our fourth district judge, but actually he was our first and fourth district judge again.
Yes, the same district judge. We were fortunate enough that day to get the same district judge that put the court order on the prosecution 6 months previously, to provide me with evidence. He was very surprised to see me, even more surprised when he saw the amount of hearings I'd attended. And he pointed me in the direction of the criminal procedure rules and the ones that are about a speedy trial, the ones about... because actually a trial should be started and finished within 4 weeks, unless, you know, there's reasonable grounds to delay it. This went on for 9 or 10 before it got resolved. So there was all sorts of breaches there, the fact they hadn't provided me with evidence, they'd broken his orders. So he told me to write a chronology. He told me to write a chronology, but as an order, he said, I'm requesting you do it. You don't have to do it, but we'll write on the record if you're agreeable. He said, if you can, because you're the only person who's been present in every hearing, and if you could write a list, and you've got all your paperwork, of everything that's happened, submit it to the court and the prosecution, and they have to argue against it if they think it's not accurate.
The first magistrates you had, both sets of magistrates you had, weren't always most agreeable and cooperative. You found most of the district judges that you'd had, although quite bemused by the state of your case, were actually fairly patient with you along the way. So we'd had three different prosecutors who'd come to the three rescheduling hearings with the district judges, and we had another prosecutor for the first two hearings. So...
Yeah, so this is the one that we'd been waiting to come back off sick so we could get on and get the case dealt with. Well, she started by saying, you've got me on the back foot, Missy. Yeah. it's kind of a strange thing, you know, it's not where I intended to be, I just want to get on with it, you know, but...
The analogy is...
Yeah, the analogy is a fencing analogy, isn't it? You've beaten me, sort of, you know, which way do I fall? So we knew immediately that, you know, we kind of knew anyway, the paperwork was really strong. They, you know, they don't know how to do their job. If you make them do a job, they will mess it up, I reckon, most of
and
the time.
You picked out the parts of the criminal procedure rules that you'd marked out. Now, section one of the criminal procedure rules, it generally refers to what the objective of any criminal trial, any criminal procedure is. The second part refers to people's obligations within that, the obligations of the prosecution, the defence and the bench. And the third part is the stipulations within that. Now, a large number of those have the judge may or the bench may, at his discretion, order or make certain stipulations. But there are a number also there that are musts.
Yes, yeah, where the bench it must. Makes a big difference. You know, if you look at the criminal procedure rules, look for the wording, whether it's a must or a may, because if it's a must, you can hold them to it.
Yeah, and in this case, a district judge or a magistrate may make a court order. If a district judge or a magistrate makes a court order, and in this case, the district judge made an order for disclosure to be made within 28 days, the magistrate's made a court order for a response within 14 days of receipt of the abuse of process argument. So there are two court orders, and if a court order is breached, the bench must address it. And so that was that was why there that they the prosecutor must have known that and realised that was why she was on the back foot.
Well, no, their way of trying to deal with it was she said her witnesses didn't turn up.
Which
it's obvious that they didn't bring the witnesses, because to bring the witnesses is a huge unnecessary expense. But you know, her comments, "You've got me on the back foot," don't suggest I haven't got my witnesses. It suggests I don't know.
I don't have my evidence that you've been asking for, so that I can make a valid charge against you.
Yeah, and it became very clear when the magistrates did arrive and the trial started to resume, part of her trial finally, that there clearly had been an abusive process. In fact, the magistrates were asking me if I wanted to continue into an abusive process hearing there and then. And so I needed to clarify where we were at, and I said, are the charges against me dismissed? And I said, yes, they are. And I'm free to go. Yes, you are. And I said, then I've got no interest in any further hearings.
I would just like to be compensated for the time
and then we asked about expenses. We weren't at all sure that we would get expenses, but, you know, we put a lot of time and effort. You know, it hasn't just been what we're talking about, and we'll get onto that in a minute about some of the other things we do to prepare us for court and the help we've had and support. So we asked for £900 expenses, and I expected to meet a lot of resistance over that, and I didn't. They were very polite through the whole thing. I thought they might bring me a cup of tea at one point. You know, it was so different. You know, normally I'm ordered to the back or stood in the dock, and because we'd proved that we weren't being treated fairly, suddenly we were up the front of the court, everybody's being ever so polite, helping me. They're responding to my Mackenzie friend, Fabrice, who they've absolutely ignored up until that point. They allow him to talk to me, he's not allowed to address the court, and all of a sudden it's, "Good morning, Mr. Bardsley." You know, and yeah, a total change of attitude, because they'd sat there before and told me absolutely, you know, that magistrate that had to speak to me that day was the one that was saying, they will respond to you. And I'm saying, what if they don't? And he's thinking that it's the most outrageous question I've ever asked.
But a few weeks later, respond, and your case has been borne
out. So the only argument over costs was whether it was a wasted costs order, which comes out of the prosecution's budget, or a central costs order, which comes out of everybody's budget. And it was apparently agreed that it would be a central costs order. I think the legal clerk was very clear with them that she wanted it to be that, because she was aware that the courts had also abused the process. They'd called wrong hearings, they'd made mistakes, they'd called hearings that weren't the right type of hearing and didn't have the right people there. You know, there was a whole list of mistakes that she herself was really responsible for, and she knew we'd left them alone.
And so I think the court and the bench,
they took equal responsibility in the end. In order to get my expenses, I still haven't got my £900. We are working on this, and I'm sure we'll update you as soon as it comes through. But what we have got is a defence costs order. which it's asking me to fill out a form, which we've done. There's a form attached here, but I filled out a different copy of the same form, sent it back to them. And it says here, the court has ordered that your expenses be met from central funds. The amount to be paid is subject to assessment by a member of court staff in accordance with published rates of allowances. So nowhere does it say the £900. In court, they did confirm £900, but they did say to me it has to be approved by the national taxing team. So we'll see if they argue that amount, but we obviously have evidence here that we won that case. The methods aren't originally our own. We've been studying with people in the States and Australia.
Well, that was what I was going to mention in terms of you mentioned going and visiting the court beforehand and
taking people in with me. All these tips came
going to see the court, but also playing with the court in the theatre, in your mind, with your friends, with
role playing is brilliant, you know, because these methods come from really from Mark Stevens, Adventures in Legal Land was his first book, and Government Indicted is his new one.
Yeah, and www.markstevens.net. Yeah,
get a good plug in there because you know with none of this work, you know this work all originates from Mark's simple set of questions and his book and his. He has a Skype chat called the No Stake Project Room, where
Frank Rizzo 3, if you want to join it, Frank Rizzo 3, send him a message. And,
but there's a few hundred people on there, I think, probably all together, or maybe a bit less.
There's some good people
there.
There's
great people there that offer you loads of support. You can do free Skype calls where we try out every scenario that could possibly happen in court so that we're really well prepared. It does take time. You've got to be quite invested in this, but once you know, you realise that, you know, there is no obligation. It means I want to carry on and put the time and energy. I actually care when someone comes after me and wants to take my money or put penalty points on my licence, and I don't feel like I've committed a crime. Then I'm going to stand up for myself and make them prove it, and they weren't able to. But I couldn't have done it without the help of all the guys in the chat room. The phone calls at strange hours of the night because we're all on other different parts of the world. Recorded calls, every single phone call. And actually at one point Mark over in Arizona was ringing them on my behalf. Because it does help to have, you know, for them to know you're not defending your case entirely on your own. You're just representing yourself in court. Doesn't mean you're not going to get help, you know. It just means you're not going to use a solicitor. To be fair, I expected to come away with a fine, the costs and points on my licence because I thought they'd just do it anyway. But actually, if you can hold them to account, and it really helped to have that district judge. But I think you can get a lot, if you get somebody who is fair enough to hear you, you can ask them those questions, which puts them in a double bind that jurisdiction is an element of a crime and they've got to prove it. You know, I'm innocent until proven guilty, burden of proof's on the prosecution. You know, if you can get all that agreed to, but you can't just ask those three questions and get them answered, you need to use some set-up questions to so people understand where you're coming from. You need to establish that you want responsive answers to your questions, you want a fair hearing, you know. And that's what Mark has helped us so much with and all the no-stake versus to the set-up questions that mean you get your questions answered. Because just walking in there and asking those questions, they're not going to answer them. But if they've already told you they're going to answer your questions as long as they're relevant to the case, and they've already told you they're going to give you a fair hearing, it's really then difficult for them not to continue answering questions that aren't relevant.
It's a shame when it's being used for what appears to be blatant economic shakedown because it brings the rest of the judicial system into repute where trivial offences are being encouraged and they're going right out of their way with cameras and enforcement officers for completely and utterly victimless crimes, which actually take away the resources where they're really needed to deal with the socially damaging crimes that we all know and hope not to hear about.
So we will wait and see if we get our full £900 costs. We're hopeful we might, but you know, bearing aside, we weren't expecting. You know, the result was the one we hoped for. It was the best we thought we could get. So we thought we'd share it with you.
Okay. Thank you.